So today, let's see what's inside of this insect zapper from a supermarket. And this one is not from eBay, it's from a local supermarket, so it shouldn't be that dodgy. Even though you never know what slips through the safety requirements and gets to the European market. So let's start exploring it. The box shows a nice mosquito and it says it runs on 220 volts, 50 hertz. And the voltage of the grid is 600 volts, it covers 15 square meters. The cable is 1.1 meters long and it draws 3 watts. But now let's of course open the box and here it is. And is there some manual? There is some brush to clean the grid. And here's the manual, which says more or less the same as the box. And it's not in English, so I'm not going to bother you with this. Now let's take a look at the zapper instead of the manual. It's in this protective foil. And here's the plug. And you can see the grid in it and the light source, which looks like a fluorescent tube. It doesn't seem to be LED based, which is a good thing because the fluorescent tubes to attract insects usually are ultraviolet, 365 or even better, 350 nanometers. The LED based ones usually have violet LEDs, which are about 400 nanometers, which is more violet than ultraviolet, and very often the LED based ones produce so little light that it doesn't even attract anything. And now let's try to test it. Here's some label on it, and there is no switch. You basically just turn it on by plugging it in. There is the European plug on it, and it lights up, it produces a bluish light, but most of it is probably in the ultraviolet spectrum. It seems to be working. What if I poke something into the grid? It's sparking a little bit, not extremely. And when I unplug it, does it hold a charge? It doesn't seem to. There is probably a discharging resistor in it. Can I measure the voltage on the grid? It says 526 volts, which is kind of close to 600, as it claims. Maybe the 10 mega ohm internal resistance of the multimeter is pulling it down. It might be actually charging a capacitor via quite a high resistance resistor. Now let's measure how much current does it draw. 2.8 milliamps only? Really? This is way less than I expected. It claims 3 watts, but the actual power is only about 0.6 watts. And of course the power is the voltage times the current, and for AC voltages times the power factor. And I assume the power factor is 1, which is the highest it can be. So this is the apparent power, and it's also what the real power can be at its best. Okay, so the power is about 20% of what it claims, and this is for both the grid and the lamp. But now of course let's open it and see what's inside of it. There are 3 screws here, and if you flip it 180 degrees, another 3 screws here, and another 2 screws here under this, and nothing here probably. So I can see 8 screws so far. So let's unscrew all. So it's unscrewed, and this cover comes off, and there is nothing. I can see the end of the tube. And there is probably a plastic holder for it, which I can unscrew. The tube is unscrewed, or its holder actually, and this end doesn't have any contacts on it. And it seems to be screwable, and it unscrews and comes out. It's a weird fluorescent tube, which seems to be in another tube, and it seems quite dirty, and it has a screw base. It looks like E14 screw base and some marking. NMH 230 volts, 15 watts. Or is it 1.5? No, it actually looks like 15 watts. Bloody hell. This actually draws a 0.6 watts. How the tube can be 15 watts? And here the marking repeats once more and again 15 watts. No possible way. The tube looks kind of dirty inside of it, and is it cracked here? It seems to be cracked, but it's the outer glass, which is probably just a protective glass. I think it doesn't have to be necessarily airtight. Maybe it wasn't even sealed. Maybe it's open to the air on this side anyway. Of course, the inner tube has to be airtight, and it's probably filled with mercury vapor. which produces 254 nanometers when you pass a current through it, and the phosphor probably converts it from 254 nanometers to 350 or 365 nanometers. So let's try to shine a light through it to see it better. And I can see some electrode in it. And it seems to be just one terminal. So it's not a heated cathode, it's a cold cathode tube. Basically just one wire going in, and there is some big cylindrical electrode on it. And on the other side of it, there is also some electrode, but it seems like it's bent or broken off. Well, maybe this was actually smashed in transport. On this side, there is basically this kind of electrode, this kind of bell-shaped piece of metal on the wire, probably spot welded, but on the other side, it seems it fell off, and now it's wedged between the wire and the glass. Here it's pressed against the glass, and here it touches the wire. Hood still kind of works, but it's a bit questionable. Maybe the hot electrode is going to damage the glass and make it crack, even though at 0.6 watts, probably not. This seems like a damage from shipping, from the transportation. The electrode probably looked the same as this one. And of course now the question is, how this electrode is even connected to the base? I don't see basically any wire running from this side to the base. And of course the electrodes probably have some emissive layer on them to make it easier for the electrons to go from the metal into the gas. And there's some plastic stopper here. Looks like a flower. And the tube seems to be still working, but it's quite dim. But how the hell this electrode is connected to the base? Basically the wire goes from this electrode through the glass. It goes through here. And here the wire ends, and here it also cracked the glass, and it touches this metal ring, which is not a complete ring, and it ends here and here. It basically looks like this electrode doesn't go anywhere, and this is just two layers of glass. There is absolutely no wire running from here to the base. I'm just completely lost here. I'm absolutely not getting it. Is it using just a capacitive current? Is it driven using a high frequency or something? Or was there a discharge going through the inner tube and then another discharge going through the outer tube? It doesn't seem likely. But if the outer tube was also gas-filled, now the gas is gone because it's cracked. I will probably try to remove the base of it, but before this, let's actually explore the power supply in it, or whatever powers it. This probably now just opens after removing the screws, and here is the power supply. Some capacitors, diodes, or just one diode, and not much else. It doesn't seem like there would be any high frequency power supply. It all hangs on just one screw, and it rotates freely in it. And this all falls apart. Here's the grid with two wires going to it, and here it's connected to the board with really not much of it on it. Let's unscrew it and let's try to explore it and reverse engineer it, because it's quite simple. And there are of course two wires going from the board also to the tube socket here. Let's take the socket off. And that's it. And here's the bottom of the board, which is quite dirty, but there is one bigger problem. This solder joint. And this is actually the solder joint of this main cable. This is completely loose, but it was probably making a contact. Otherwise it would be completely dead. You have to be kidding me, guys. How does this even get to the European market? And here's the board, which contains a fuse, three resistors, three capacitors and two diodes. And there is probably a voltage doubler for the grid, with two capacitors, two diodes and maybe some inrush resistor and a discharging resistor. And then what's left for the tube is probably a capacitor and a resistor. So is it a capacitive dropper powering the tube and then a discharging resistor, or maybe a resistor to limit the inrush current when you plug it in? And of course, here's the schematic of it. Here's the mains plug, and the mains goes in here. Here it goes to the tip of the tube socket, and the shell goes to the other terminal of mains via a capacitor. So it's basically a capacitive dropper. And this resistor is discharging the capacitor so that there is no charge left on the plug after you unplug it, which could give you a shock. And of course, this resistor also helps to discharge the other capacitors, especially this one. And there is a fuse in the circuit, but for some reason, this part of the circuitry doesn't go through the fuse. So if something shorts here, the fuse is completely useless. I'm absolutely not getting this. The fuse is only fusing the voltage doubler for the grid, but not the power supply for the tube. And why does the fuse has to be rated 6.3 bloody amps? This thing draws just a couple milliamps. You have to be kidding me, guys. The fuse rating is more than 1000 times the actual current this is probably drawing. And of course, the whole thing could never even draw 3 watts. It's less than 1 watt and a couple milliamps. And the current is of course capacitively limited by this capacitor and this capacitor. And these capacitors are 47 nano. And of course, at most, you can have the mains voltage on them, and at this voltage they are going to pass just a couple milliamps. So let's try to do the calculation. How much current these capacitors are going to pass at a full mains voltage? The current through a capacitor is U times pi times the frequency times the capacitance times the AC voltage. And this is U times 3.14 times 50 Hz times the capacitance, but in farads, and the voltage. And I used 230 volts because nowadays this is the nominal European voltage, but it doesn't make much difference if it's 220 or 230. This is 0.0034 amps or 3.4 milliamps only. This is what the capacitors pass at the full mains voltage, which is the highest current it will ever pass in this circuit. And there are two such capacitors, so times two it's going to be 6.8 milliamps. And of course this is a voltage doubler, and this capacitor will basically pump charge into this capacitor, and after this one is charged, there is virtually no current left other than the current through this discharging resistor, which is a very high resistance. But when the grid is shorted, the current is higher. Then it's probably mostly limited by this capacitor and also this resistor, but it's in series, so this is never going to pass more than this. And also this is never going to pass more than this, even if the tube has no voltage drop. But the more voltage it drops, the less current will go through it, because there will be less voltage left for the capacitor. And of course I'm curious what's the voltage drop on this tube, but before I can measure it, I have to fix the broken solder joint. Let's just very lazily solder it back. Let's try to plug it in. It actually lights up dimly. And the AC voltage on the tube is 166 volts. And the voltage on its series dropper capacitor is 127 volts AC. And of course the capacitor is capacitive, so the voltage on the capacitor plus the voltage on the tube is more than the incoming mains voltage, because the voltages on it are out of phase. So the voltages are not just simply adding. And the mains voltage here is now 229 volts. And the tube current is 1.78 milliamps. And the grid power supply probably draws about 1 milliamp then. Even though of course the currents are not simply adding, if they are out of phase. But there is still the mystery how this electrode of the tube is connected with the base. Is there some super thin wire going, or does this glass have some transparent conductive coating on it? Let's make an autopsy of this, it's damaged anyway. But of course the inner tube contains a bit of mercury, so let's try not to break it. Here you can see some mercury beads in it. Okay, the autopsy. And the wire going from the tube seems to be soldered to this tip of the base. Let's desolder it. There is also something soldered to this shell, but where does it go? I don't really see anything obvious yet. Does it go to some conductive coating on the glass? Removing the rest of the shell, and where does this go? Let's remove this cement using scissors, my universal tool for everything. The inner tube is cemented into the outer tube. Not sure if I can remove it without breaking it. Trying to remove the cement from it. And it seems that the wire coming from the shell just wraps around the inner tube. And there might be some conductive coating on it, probably. It's not really connected to anything other than some coating, probably this weird dark layer. Does it continue into some transparent conductive layer on it? Now the inner tube is getting loose and it comes out. One end of it is basically connected to some coating at the outside of it, and this probably connects it through this wire into the shell. Let's try to measure the resistance here, and it shows about 6 kiloohms. And even when I touch the tube directly, it actually seems to be conductive. So there is some conductive coating on the outside of the inner tube, bringing this electrode to the shell. And it might also work as an inrush resistor, limiting the inrush of the capacitor in series. Or maybe was the resistance of the coating originally meant as the only current limitation? Was it meant to be connected directly to mains? Maybe. It says 230 volts, but you can't really tell if it's meant to be directly connected or via some current limiter. Maybe the resistance of the coating would be enough to limit the current. And I connected it as it originally was, and the discharge itself drops 162 volts, and the resistive coating drops 12 volts. And here's the total. And of course I should also measure the real power, instead of just the apparent power. Let's use my DIY wattmeter. Let's plug it into this 10 times more sensitive socket, because it's low power, and it draws 0.64 watts. And when the grid is shorted, 0.68 watts. The power doesn't go up much, because the current is mostly capacitively limited. When it's shorted, most of the voltage is on this capacitor. Just a small part of it is on this resistor. And now, of course, let's try to connect the tube to mains, without the series capacitor, to see if it was originally intended to be used like this. I'm actually putting a 100 watt lamp in series. If there is a massive current, it will limit the current and light up. But if the current isn't super high, this lamp will drop just a little voltage and it won't skew the measurement much. I'm putting the tube into a mercury splash container and it lights up and it draws 4.2 watts. It's dropping to 3.4 watts. It was much brighter, but it's flickering. 1.7 watts. It might actually be intended for mains voltage directly. And the power settles at 1.6 watts. And the 10 times more sensitive socket shows 1.56. And the current is about 6 milliamps. So let's sum it up. It was smashed in transportation, there was a completely loose solder joint, the fuse rating is way too high and it only fuses half of the circuit, and the power of the lamp is so low that it can hardly attract any insect. I'm not an expert, but this seems like an utter rubbish to me. And of course, please consider supporting my channel on Patreon. This really helps me a lot. And big thanks to all of you who already support me. And in the next episode, maybe the autopsy of this high voltage oscilloscope probe.